We begin Brain Series 2, Episode 2, with Patricia Churchland.
From a historical perspective, there really have always been two traditions. One started with Hippocrates in ancient Greece, who really did believe that mental activity was nothing other than activity in the physical brain. The other line was really initiated by Plato, who thought that there was somehow an independent thing, the soul. Mm-hmm. Now, this really got its fullest development with Descartes in the 17th century. And in Descartes' view, there was the physical body, and it had all of the properties that we understand about physical things, and then there was the non-physical soul that had no physical properties whatever. This was just a causal device. This had the properties of creativity, of perception, of feeling, of reason. And then, how do they interconnect? And that was the crushing problem that Descartes could not solve. So if we fast forward to the 19th century, the great German scientist, who was both a physiologist and a psychologist and everything in between, was Hermann von Helmholtz. And
extraordinary man.
Helmholtz realized, he formulated the law of conservation of energy, and he realized that if by some miracle this non-physical soul affected the body, that this well-established physical law would be trashed. So Helmholtz took the view that it's almost certainly, despite appearances, it's almost certainly all physical. It's the brain. And then what he did was study perception. And in the course of studying perception, he came to the realization that a lot of non-conscious processing is not just reflexive and dumb, it's adaptive and smart.
Creative.
It's creative. And that one of the things that the brain, the non-conscious brain does is assemble basic bits of information from the sensory systems and makes an inference. And I'm going to show you some very scanty information that the brain will use to make an inference of a very complex sort. And so when you look at that, it's a series of black lines. Doesn't seem to mean anything. But when it begins to move, your brain makes an inference. It's a person. It's not just a person. It's kicking. It's jumping. It's actually a man. And people think of it as being a young man. And all of this comes out of just movement of those small splotches. So Helmholtz realized that the brain is very constructive, that the non-conscious brain sort of delivers to consciousness something that integrates across a whole lot of information and brings information that's stored as well as what's currently perceived. Now I'll say a little bit about Freud, because I think Freud picked up on this idea. Now, the early Freud was an aphasiologist, and that means that he was interested in the various defects in the capacity to speak. And Freud, in thinking about speech, made this very interesting observation, which many of us have, but he took it a step further. He noticed that, of course, we don't consciously pick the words that we're going to use. We don't consciously form the grammatical structure. That's somehow all done for us non-consciously, and we just speak. In fact, I sort of know the gist of what I'm going to say, but I don't know precisely what I'm going to say until I say it. And so he too thought the non-conscious processes are not stupid and reflexive and automatic. They're adaptive, they're smart, they're complex. Fast forward again, and now into about 1980, when Bernard Barres realized that many of the questions that came to us at the beginning of the 20th century were these. What's the difference in the brain when something is conscious and when it's not? What's the mechanism whereby something that's not conscious becomes conscious? And how smart really are non-conscious processes? And if they're really smart, what does that leave for consciousness? Is it just an epiphenomenon that's kind of a nice glow that we like, or is it functional? So he developed a framework, and the framework tried to pull together certain ideas from psychology in such a way that ultimately they would fit with neuroscience, and we can see that now happening. The ideas were, first of all, that consciousness has a limited capacity. I can't pay attention to two conversations at once. It's also extremely important when we need to deal with a novel and complex problem. I walk into the kitchen, the electric stove is on fire, I need to be conscious in order to pull out of my knowledge system that I better find the baking soda and dump it on. He also knew that whatever else is true about consciousness, that what we're aware of is the product of very complex integration. So when I look at your face, I don't consciously see some eyes and an eyebrow and some ears and a mouth and say, ah, yes, that's got to be it. Oh, and look who that is. It just comes to me. I don't have to consciously figure anything out. And so his question really was, what's the nature of all of that integration that allows us to see something complex? And so Bars then thought that these observations about the psychological character of consciousness could probably come to fit with developments in neuroscience if we knew what to look for. And that's what's happened.
All right, Stanislaus, let me talk about how you can approach consciousness empirically through a kind of experimentation.
Well, as you know, there's been enormous progress in the ability to see the brain in action with brain imaging techniques, and there's a whole variety of them allowing you to see the brain in three dimensions and also in the dimension of time. And the main problem has been to try to find experimental paradigms that would allow us to bring into the lab this contrast between non-conscious and conscious processing. And it's true, it's thanks to Bernard Barthes' book that psychologists suddenly realized that they had many techniques at their disposal. Before that book, I would say that the question of consciousness in psychology was quite taboo. People didn't speak about it. They did not consider it a topic which would be worthy.
Worthy problem.
Exactly. With this book, they realized that, in fact, there were many techniques that allowed us to play with consciousness in a lab. Basically, now we have an enormous variety of techniques that allow us to take any stimulus, any image, maybe a face, maybe a word, and we can play with it as well and make it come and go in and out of your consciousness as we wish. I'm going to show you a demonstration of this. Okay. If we look at this demonstration, what we will see is the words 1, 2, 3, 4. And we can flash them very quickly, and still you see them. It's not really the speed with which they are presented which makes them invisible. But what we are going to do now is we are going to take these words, and very closely, just before and just after, we're going to put other shapes. And you should see that the word four disappears, because now the duration is just right. Okay? There was no word four.
Yeah.
Well, the word four is still there on the screen. It's still there on your retina. It's being processed by the brain, but it's not conscious. And there are other situations like that where the brain flips between conscious and unconscious states. So this is a sort of ideal experimental situation. Then we can use our brain imaging tools and look inside the brain and ask what's the difference, right? So on the screen now, what you see is what happens to a subliminal word. It starts in the visual cortex at the back of the brain. It's very active there. You can have a lot of activity which is non-conscious. But it's a sort of dying wave. You see, it's a wave that comes inside the brain, and after 200, 300 milliseconds, it will slowly die out without reaching the higher centers of the parietal and frontal cortex.
But even this is so surprising, because I think if you were to ask most of us 30 years ago to what degree does an unconscious perception reach the cerebral cortex, we would have not. We said no.
In fact, it's processed inside the cortex. It's processed in many different areas of the cortex.
Very important finding.
But when it's conscious, there is something quite different going on. It's an amplification of activity. And we see it now with the very same starting point. Now the activity in the brain is being amplified, and after maybe a third of a second, it becomes very large. It's like a tsunami instead of a dying wave. You know, and it gets into higher spots in the brain, especially in the prefrontal cortex, in the front of the of the brain. And from there, it's also, it's a bidirectional wave. It goes back to the original spots where it started. So it creates a sort of reverberation, yeah. And this is the broadcasting of information that occurs when you're conscious. So in terms of psychology, what happens when you're conscious is that the information becomes available in the system, which becomes detached from the external world. The world was extremely brief at the beginning, but it becomes stable in your mind, and you can keep it in mind. This is what we call working memory. You can hold it in conscious mind and broadcast it to all of the areas that need it. So we can say that conscious information is information which is available in the brain, basically, globally available. And this is the global workspace model. We begin to know the areas that are being concerned, but there's still a lot of mysteries to be solved. And one of the mysteries is that from experiment to experiment, we see that non-conscious processing can go to very different depths in the brain, actually. So we will see that in the next slide. We have shown that word recognition can occur in the brain non-consciously. Face recognition can occur in the brain non-consciously. But even much higher levels, like the meaning of the word, is being accessed without your consciousness. If it's a number, you will access the mathematical systems of your brain. If it guides you to command a gesture, this will be activated in your brain at the level of the motor cortex. Other aspects like the sound of a word, or whether it's an emotional word or not, whether it's an error that you made and you want to capture the error, all of that can be computed non-consciously. So it still is a struggle to try to understand how there can be so much non-conscious processing, but basically the finding is always the same. Non-conscious processing is local, it's local in time, it's small, and conscious activity is being amplified and connected broadly across the brain. That's the main finding from brain imaging.
All right, Tim, let me turn to you and talk about how much of our thinking is unconscious.
Well, behavioral research psychologists for many years have been looking at everyday kinds of judgment and decisions to see if we can tease apart to what degree they occur consciously and unconsciously. And it's a very exciting time. A picture is emerging of the mind as having two very different ways of thinking. One is the slow, deliberate, conscious kind of thought we're all familiar with. But the other, that we refer to as the adaptive unconscious, seems to be quite powerful and sophisticated, able to monitor what's going on around us, interpret incoming information, make decisions even for us. Now, as Eric said, dividing the mind into the conscious and the unconscious does remind us of Sigmund Freud, a brilliant thinker who also talked about conscious and unconscious processing. I think Freud's emphasis was on a somewhat different kind of unconscious. He mostly referred to the unconscious as the seat of the primordial instincts, the urges that arise in childhood that we're often trying to repress and keep hidden. The modern view certainly doesn't deny that powerful kind of unconscious, but expands it to look at more sophisticated, higher level kind of thinking that we couldn't live without. Now, how do we know this? Well, there's some very interesting experiments going on. Freud was at a disadvantage in that he didn't have the modern methods that we now have to look at conscious and unconscious processing. And a number of experiments have been done, some similar to the methodology that Stanislav has talked about, where words are flashed at very quick speed so that people don't see them consciously. But then we look at how that influences later judgments and decisions. So in one early experiment by John Barge, for example, people were flashed words that they didn't see consciously. And then they were given a description of a guy named Donald. Donald was described as in his apartment, and a salesman came to the door, and he abruptly sent the salesman away. In another segment, he goes to a hardware store and buys a gadget and immediately demands his money back. Well, what do we make of Donald? Is he kind of hostile, or is he just assertive? Well, it depended on the words that people saw in the first part of the experiment. Some of the participants saw words, again, saw in quotation marks because they didn't consciously see these words, but words that had to do with hostility, hostile, unfriendly, unkind, whereas those in a control condition saw neutral words like table and chair. And indeed, the ones who saw the flashes of the words connoting unkindness thought that Donald wasn't a very nice guy. They thought, man, he's kind of hostile. Whereas those in the control condition who saw the neutral words kind of gave him the benefit of the doubt and said, well, I guess Donald's just kind of assertive. And many experiments of this type have portrayed the adaptive unconscious as being able to interpret information, to learn many things about the world. And an example there is language acquisition. As children, we just soak up language automatically. We're not doing it consciously. Monitoring the world, we're able to keep track of what's going on around us while we focus consciously on one thing, but there's part of our mind which is making sure something important isn't happening elsewhere. And some of the most interesting work is on decision making. So many of us, when faced with an important choice, have taken out that proverbial piece of paper and made the line and made deliberate lists of pluses and minuses mm-hmm. to try to tell us what to do. But experiments have shown that that may not be the best way, that if we are overly conscious about a decision, we can sometimes talk ourselves into thinking we prefer something we really don't. And it might be better to, by all means, we should get as much information as we should about the decision. We shouldn't be so impulsive that we just go with the first thing that comes to mind. But once we have all that information, it's best to let it percolate unconsciously and bubble up into a preference without being overly deliberative and thoughtful about it. All of this work suggests that the adaptive unconscious is vital to our survival. It works in hand with consciousness to guide us in ways that really make us the smartest species on Earth. Mm-hmm.